Good afternoon and Jai Hind children. I welcome you all in your English class today. Today I'll be discussing the second chapter of your English literature book, that is The Signal Man. I want to share with you that Julius Caesar, John F. Kennedy and Abraham Lincoln, all of them had premonition of their death. And you know, a premonition is a strong feeling that especially something negative, something bad is about to happen. And the same feeling is there with the signal man. Signal man also feels that something bad is about to happen. He is extremely troubled. And let us find out why. Hello, below there. When he heard a voice thus calling to him, instead of looking up to where I stood on the top of the steep cutting nearly over his head, he turned himself about and looked down the line. There was something remarkable in his manner of doing so, though I could not have said for my life what. So, here, as I told you, we have two main characters in the story. First one is the signal man, as you know, and the other one is narrator. We have the third one also, and you are going to know about that third character later in the story. Now, so, narrator is calling the signal man, and the narrator is standing somewhere on the high ground, and he's looking down. He finds that signal man is standing there, and then he calls him, "Hello, below there." But what happens, and this is a very strange thing, that signal man, instead of looking towards the narrator, he starts looking towards the tunnel. Okay, because the voice wasn't coming from the tunnel. The voice was coming from the above. So, this was something uncommon, something notable for the narrator. And then he wonders, why? I am calling him from this place and he started looking towards the tunnel. What is wrong with this man? Okay. Hello, below. I called out again. And when the narrator found that the signal man is not paying heed to or not paying attention to what the narrator is saying, he calls him again. He calls, "Hello, below." Raising his eyes, he saw my figure high above him. So finally, the signal man, he raised his eyes and then he found that there is someone standing there. "Is there any path by which I can come down and speak to you?" Now, the narrator asks to the signal man that, "I want to come down. Can you please tell me any way? Because it's a very, you know, high place and I just can't find out any place to come down to meet you." And then the signal man, okay, he tells him. After a pause, during which he seemed to regard me with fixed attention, he motioned with his rolled up flag towards a point on my level. Some 200 or 300 yards distant, I found a rough zigzag descending path notched out, which I followed. And then what happened? After a few seconds, the signalman, he starts looking towards the man and then he starts understanding what the narrator was saying. And when he understands that fully, completely, and then he tells the signal man that, okay, so from his curled up flag, he shows a way, which was almost 100 yards away from the narrator. Okay, 200 or 300 yards away from the narrator. And it was a zigzag path from which the narrator came down. It was a zigzag path. It was not a smooth road or a very comfortable path to walk on. The cutting was extremely deep and unusually precipitate. It was made through a clammy stone that became oozier and wetter as I went down. So the cutting, it was extremely deep, it was extremely sharp and very steep. Okay, and there were so many clammy, like damp and, you know, slimy stones were there. So when he was walking on those stones, they became oozier. Okay. Now, his post was in as solitary and dismal a place as ever I saw. On either side, a dripping wet wall of jagged stone, excluding all view but a strip of sky. So here, when the narrator finally gets down, he finds where the signalman lives. And he does not find that place at all pleasant. So now we are knowing more about the place where the signalman was staying. It was a solitary place. Okay, it was away from the hustle and bustle of the city. Okay, it was not so many people were not there. It was a solitary place. It was a lonely place. It was dismal. It was gloomy, dark. Okay, and it was depressing. It was not a pleasant place, as I told you just now. On either side, a dripping wet wall of jagged stone. So, on either side of the railway line, of the railway track, dripping wet wall of jagged stone, jagged as sharp, unevenly cut stones, okay, was there. And nothing could be seen, only a strip of sky. So, even the sky could be seen a little. Okay, that was also not much visible. At one end of the long corridor of stone was the gloomy entrance to a black tunnel. And then he tells that long corridor of stone was the gloomy, dim and dark, gloomy is dim and dark, entrance to a black tunnel. So this was a place where he was staying, in whose massive architecture there was a barbarous, depressing and forbidding air. So he finds out that the place is not at all pleasant to stay. And he finds that it was barbarous, it was like rough, it was depressing. Okay, it had a forbidding air. At the mouth of the tunnel was a red light. So at the mouth of the tunnel, near the entrance of the tunnel, there was a red light. And we all know what red signifies. Red signifies danger, right? So little sunlight ever found its way to this spot that it had an earthly, deadly smell, and so much cold wind rushed through it that it struck chill to me as if I had left the natural world. So just focus on this, that the place where the signalman was staying, it was not at all pleasant. It was depressing, it was dismal, dark, and it was not livable for the people like us. Okay, we always prefer some place which is well lit, which is happy, surrounded by people, happy people. Okay, but this place was not like that at all, where the signalman was staying. So the narrator feels that when he reaches to that place, he feels that, you know, as if he has left the natural world and he has gone to some other place. Some place other than all the places that he had ever seen. Okay, it was not at all good. He was not having this good feeling that he has come to a new place, but it was not a happy place. It was dark, dismal. Okay, now, drawing nearer to him, I saw that he was a dark, sallow man with a dark beard and rather heavy eyebrows. His attitude was one of such expectation and watchfulness that I stopped a moment wondering at it. So when he came down, okay, when the narrator came down, he looked towards the signalman and then he found out that he was a sallow man. Sallow means unhealthy, of a pale complexion. He was having dark eyebrows and beard, and the eyebrows were really heavy. But his attitude was of expectation and watchfulness. He was observing, he was very watchful, he was observing something, okay, like everywhere, fine. Then for this the narrator stopped for a moment and then he started wondering at it, like why this person is always watchful, why he is always observing, what is wrong with this man. He took me into his box where there was a fire, a desk for an official book in which he had to make certain entries, a telegraphic instrument with its dial, pace and needles, and the little bell of which he had spoken. He was several times interrupted by the bell and had to read off messages and send replies. Once he had to stand without the door and display a flag as a train passed and make some verbal communication to the driver in the discharge of his duties, I observed him to be remarkably exact and vigilant. Okay, breaking off his discourse at a syllable and remaining silent until what he had to do was done. So when the narrator came down, the signalman took the narrator to his box. Okay, so this was the box in which he was staying, and he was staying here, you know, since so many years. So it had you know, minimal things, very few things were there in the box. So what were those things? It had a bell, a fire, and a small book. Okay, a telegraphic instruments, very few things that were required for the signalman to perform his duties. So nothing more. Okay, and also he found, the narrator observed, that the signalman was a very watchful person, and he knew how to perform his duties well. He did every possible thing. He took, you know, every time the train came, he came out of his box, he showed the signal to the train, had some conversation with the driver, and then observing the bell as well, writing something on his entry book. So all these things were done by the signalman perfectly well. He did not make any mistake in that. Okay, that was observed by the narrator. Now, in a word, I should have set this man down as one of the safest men to be employed in that capacity. But for the circumstance that while he was speaking to me, he twice broke off with a fallen color, turned his face towards the little bell when it did not ring, opened the door of the hut which was kept shut to exclude the unhealthy damp, and looked out towards the red light near the mouth of the tunnel. So what happened? At this time, the narrator is sitting with the signalman inside his box. And here he found out that the signalman knows how to do his work. He did everything with exactitude. He did everything perfectly well. And that is why the narrator called the signalman as one of the safest men. Okay. Because there was no scope, there was no place of committing an error in his work by the signalman. But what happened when they started having the conversation, the signalman broke the conversation and he started staring towards the bell. And he came out of the box all of a sudden and he started looking for someone. Okay, this he did without telling or without, you know, taking an excuse from the narrator. Because when you are talking to someone, and if because of some reason, like if you have to take a call or something else, you excuse yourself, okay, and then you go out or move out of the room in which you are having the conversation with the other person. But this was not done by the signalman. He, when he was talking to the narrator, he felt something, started looking towards the bell, and then he moved out of the box, right? Without taking any excuse from the narrator. Now, on both of those occasions, he came back to the fire with the inexplicable air upon him, which I had earlier noticed. When I asked him what the matter was, he replied in a low voice, "I'm troubled, sir, I'm troubled." So, what happened? So, when he found that twice, the signalman started staring towards the bell, and he moved out, started looking towards the tunnel, and then he came back with this a sad expression, with this mysterious expression on his face, the narrator decided that he has to ask what is wrong with this man. Okay, so finally he asks the signalman that, is everything fine with you, or is there something that's bothering you? So, to which the signalman replies, "Sir, I am troubled." And the way he says that convinces the narrator that he is actually troubled, bothered, and anxious about something. Now, trouble means, like, I'm troubled means beset by problem or difficulties, is facing from something, okay, something which is extremely negative and sad. Now, wait a moment, what is your trouble? So the narrator asks the signalman, what is the trouble? What is it that's troubling you? or that's bothering you. It is very, very difficult to speak of, sir. If you ever make me another visit, I'll try to tell you. So, the narrator, the single man feels that it would not be good to share something negative with the person who has come to meet him like the first time. So he tells him, because he's actually bothered or anxious, so the single man, he tells him that, you know, at this moment it's not easy for me to make you understand what I'm going through, but if you pay me another visit, I would surely try to make you understand what's going on with me. Okay, now I will come at 11 tomorrow. So the narrator, he wants to know what is wrong with this man whom he thinks that is, he is the safest man on this place. So the narrator promises him, okay, he tells him that, okay, no problem. If you want me to pay another visit, I'll surely come at 11 tomorrow. Punctual to my appointment, I reached his box the next night as the distant clocks were striking 11 and sat down by the fire. So the next day, he went to meet the signalman at the decided time. Okay. Now, as soon as we were seated, he started speaking in a tone, but a little above a whisper. So now, when they both are having this conversation, where the narrator wants the signalman to tell him what's bothering him. They both are sitting on each side of the table. The fire is there, okay, and it's keeping the signal box warm. And the signalman starts telling him about the trouble. But he's not speaking in a very, audible, voice. It is a little above the whisper. A whisper is like when we say some secrets to our friends. So we whisper so that others don't know what we are talking about. The same way, signal man is also telling the narrator about something, but he is not much audible. He is just telling him in a voice that is a little above the whisper, or in a tone that is a little above the whisper. Okay. One moonlit night, so now he starts, and now you would also come to know that what was it that was bothering the signal man. Now, one moonlit night about a year ago, said the man, I was sitting here when I heard a voice cry, hello below there. I started up, looking from that door, and saw someone standing by the red light near the tunnel, waving with one hand and the other covering his eyes. His voice seemed hoarse with shouting and it cried, look out, look out. So what happened? He tells the narrator, okay, the signal man starts telling the thing that's bothering him, and that is something which is not pleasant, not to me at all, okay, because I'm not into something that is scary, okay. Now, so the narrator, he's listening, and the signal man starts telling him that, sir, about a year ago, it was a moonlit night, so in moonlit night what happens? Things are visible but not much. Okay. So once he heard, when he was sitting in a signal box, he heard someone calling, hello below there. So he understood that someone is standing somewhere and he is calling him. So the signal man took his lamp and then he moved out of his signal box. And then he found that there was someone who was standing near the mouth of the tunnel. And then he observed that the man who was standing near the tunnel, he is asking him to look out, look out. So, and the voice was rough, it was harsh. And then he is telling him, hello below there, look out, look out. As if he is telling him to, or warning him about something. Okay, so I caught up my lamp, turned it on red and ran towards the figure calling, what's wrong? What has happened? Where? I stood just outside the blackness of the tunnel. I advanced so close upon it that I wondered at it keeping the sleeve across its eyes. I ran right up at it and had my hand stretched out to pull the sleeve away when it was gone. So, when I heard the voice, now the suicide by the signal man. That when I heard the voice of, I took my lamp. I held my lamp in my hand, and then I moved out of my signal box, and then I started observing, and then I found that there is someone who is standing near the mouth of the tunnel, near the entrance of the tunnel. I started running towards the figure, and when I stretched my hand, I found that particular thing, whatever it was, it disappeared. I could touch his arm, but he wasn't there within a snap. And then, now, after we had sat silently for a while, he slowly added these words, touching my arm. Within 6 hours after the appearance, the memorable accident on this line happened. And within 10 hours, the dead and the wounded were brought along through the tunnel over the spot where the figure had stood. So here, the signal man is talking about the first accident. And it was a memorable accident. So many people lost their lives. And you know where the dead bodies were kept? Where the figure was seen. Okay, where the figure has appeared. So, and right after, you know, appearance of that figure, within 10 hours of that, that accident took place. Just imagine. A disagreeable shudder crept over me, but I did my best against it. 6 or 7 months passed and I had recovered from the surprise and shock. When one morning, as the day was breaking, I, standing at the door, looked towards the red light and saw the spectre again. He stopped with a fixed look at me. So, when he told him about the memorable accident, the narrator, he felt a shiver. Okay, he felt fearful. He got scared. But he tried to hide that feeling. Okay, he calmed him down. And then what happened? The signal man, he just continues. And then he tells him that, like 6 or 7 months passed. And then I was like recovered from this incident. But what happened, to my shock and surprise, one morning when I just moved out of my signal box and the day was breaking, I standing at the door, looked towards the red light and saw the specter again. And the place where he has seen the specter, and specter is a ghost, okay? So I saw him there again, with a fixed look at me. Did it cry out? So now the narrator asks, what did he do there then? This time, what did he do? And then he says, and then he asks, actually, did it cry out? No, it was silent. Did it wave its arm? No, it leaned against the shaft of the light with both hands before the face like this. And then what happened? The signal man tells the narrator, no, sir, it did not shout. It did not say anything. But near the ray of light, the beam of light, he was just standing with his face covered with both of his hands, as if he's mourning, he's expressing his sadness over something. And then what happened? I have seen such an attitude in stone figures on tombs. Tombs like a large, grave that is above the ground, and you will find there are so many figures, which are there. Decorated on it. So I came in and sat down, partly to collect my thoughts, partly because it had turned me faint. When I went to the door again, daylight was above me and the ghost was gone. So when he found the specter there again, to relax himself, to calm himself down, the signal man came back to his box. He sat down to just relax. Okay, and then what happened? When he collected his thoughts, when he tried to calm him down, after relaxing, he moved out and no one was there near the tunnel. Whoever was there was gone. Now, but nothing followed. Now the narrator asked, did anything happen after that? Nothing came of this. He touched me on the arm with his forefinger twice or thrice, giving a ghastly nod each time. That very day, as the train came out of the tunnel, I noticed at a carriage window on my side what looked like the confusion of hands and heads and something waved. I saw it just in time to signal the driver, stop. He shut off and put his brake on. I ran after it, and as I went along, heard terrible screams and cries. A beautiful young lady had died instantaneously in one of the compartments and was brought in here and laid down on the floor between us. So what happened? The signalman continued when the narrator asked that when you saw the specter again, did anything happen after that? And then the signalman, he touches the narrator's arm and then he tells him. And then he says, actually, so one day what happened when I moved out of my signal box, I found that a train was coming and I could not understand actually because something was confusing me. I couldn't make out whether it was hand or it was head, and someone was waving at me, and when I found that something wrong is about to happen, I showed my signal and I asked the driver, the train driver, to stop the train. And the driver did exactly the same. He just pulled the brake. But what happened? A beautiful young lady. Okay, so the one, the signalman was confused about was a young lady who was waving her arm. So probably she wanted to stop the train, or she wanted to say something which could not be understood by the signalman. And she died and her body was kept where the narrator and the signalman were having a conversation, right? Okay. Involuntarily, I pushed my chair back as I looked from the boards at which he pointed to himself. I could think of nothing to say to any purpose, and my mouth was dry. He resumed. Now, so mark this, and judge how my mind is troubled. The spectre came back a week ago. Ever since it had been there now and again by fits and starts. At the light? At the danger light? What does it seek to do? And then what happens? The narrator. Okay, when he understood, when he, listens to the story of the young lady, just passing away, then he understand that. Involuntarily, because when he was told that the lady was kept there where the signalman and the narrator were having their conversation, he, without thinking, okay, he just pulled his chair back as to say, as if he was saving himself from the dead body, okay? So, he pulled his chair back. And after that, what happened? He asked him, okay, he told him, sir, the signalman, he asked the narrator, now did you understand how much I'm troubled? And also a week ago, by fits and starts, like every now and then, I am seeing the specter there. And then the narrator asked, near the light, near the danger light, what does it seem to do? And then he asked that, did you find the specter at the same place? And what was he doing this time? He repeated, if possible with increased passion and vehemence, that former gesticulation of, for God's sake, clear the way. And the signalman said, yes sir, he wasn't quiet when he was standing near the danger light. He said, for God's sake, clear the way. So this was the thing that was told to the signalman by the specter. Okay. Then he went on, I have no peace or rest for it. It calls to me for many minutes together in an agonized manner. Below there, look out, it stands waving to me, it rings my little bell. I caught at that. Did it ring your bell yesterday evening when I was here and you went to the door? Twice. Why, see, said I, how your imagination misleads you. My eyes were on the bell and my ears were open to the bell, and I am a living man. It did not ring at those times. He shook his head. I don't wonder that you failed to hear it, but I heard it. And did the specter seem to be there when you looked out? It was there. Both times? He repeated formally. Both times. What troubles me so dreadfully, sir, is the question, what does the spectre mean? I was not sure, I told him that I did fully understand. Okay, now we'll stop here, right? So now let me explain what happened after that. So when the narrator pulled his chair back without, you know, having a thought, okay, so here he just did that. And then he asked that you found the specter there near the tunnel again, the same pace, was he doing something? And then the signalman told him, sir, yes, he was just saying for God's sake near the way, as if the signalman was standing on the railway track and the specter was requesting him to go, you know, off the track. And he was just repeating the same thing, the specter was repeating the same thing, below there, look out, as if he wants him to, you know, pay attention to the railway line and to the things around it, okay. And whenever the specter calls, the signalman, he always calls him in a very sad, you know, tone, okay, as if he's very sad about something wrong, okay. Now, so the narrator tells him that what happened after that, and then he tells him that actually, sir, the bell also ran. And yesterday when you were sitting here, the bell ran. And then the narrator, he relaxes a little and then he says, see how your imagination escapes you? Actually, I was here and I'm a living man. I'm a safe, healthy, perfect man. And when I was here, I found that you were observing the bell, but the bell did not ring. So it might be your illusion. Okay, it might be your imagination. Because the bell did not ring, I was standing here and I couldn't hear anything. So, the signalman said, I don't wonder. See, I don't mind you think like this, but it's me only who can, you know, hear the bell when it rings. And when I went out of the signal box, I found that specter there again. And so what happens? Okay. Now, the only thing the signalman says after that to the narrator is, sir, actually the thing is, I'm not bothered, okay? I know that, you know, the specter would be seen every now and then because he has become a little accustomed to that. What bothers the signalman is that why the specter always appears in front of me. I am a man of no power. I don't have any power in my hand. So if something wrong is about to happen, why don't he go to someone who has the power and will to act? Because I'm just a signalman. All I would do is, after seeing the specter or to be I'm warned, is to show the signal to the train. So why doesn't the specter go to someone who has the power to act? So this is the thing that bothers the signalman. Also, another thing that is, and that is the main thing that bothers the signalman whenever he finds the specter, is something wrong is about to happen. So that is a premonition. Okay. So the signalman understands that if he has seen the specter there near the mouth of the tunnel or near the entrance of the tunnel, something wrong will surely happen. Because it had happened twice and now this is the third time that the specter appeared there. So I have explained this part of the story, and I would be explaining the remaining part of the story in the part 2. Okay, so I'm going to share the link of this video with you so that it would be easy for you to understand the story better. And do message me about anything you couldn't understand in the story. Okay, children? So thank you so much.